that's the still update, this evening. We will have Nathan Foy, Caesar Games, and Adam Nickton with us all. So, who else would like to? Editor?
Great.
Sorry, that was my mic turned on. Everybody's here.
Yes, we are here.
Indeed. Oh, it's all right.
I had a great start to the show. My mic wasn't turned on.
I hope I did okay there. Yeah.
And we also have Cesar there as well, over in Mexico.
Yes, yeah, I'm here. How are you, people?
Fine, I think.
Oh, yes, Cesar.
Very good.
Alive
nice to meet you again.
Yeah.
And we're here to talk about the tropics more than anything, but if you do have a comment or question on the streaming page, do send us a message. It doesn't have to be related to what we're going to be talking about. Just send it in and we'll oblige. Who'd like to kick us off?
Well,
don't all jump up at once.
Well, I need to say something, I think. But well, recently we heard about that Bunny has reformed again and now it's a tropical depression just in the east coast of North Carolina.
Yeah.
And is, well, the current track forecast is that she will getting far off land without intensifying, but recognized plane will fly around the system and tell us about if Bonnie is still a tropical depression or can be a tropical storm in the next 24 to 48 hours. So far, Bonnie has killed two people when she was active in the last week. And maybe we could see another system in the Caribbean Sea. Could affect the Cayman Islands, Cuba, and possibly Florida by the next week. I don't know. What do you want to say, guys? What do you think?
Before we do go on to the possible next tropical system, just let me give the technicals on tropical depression Bonnie. As of the 11 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time advisory, Bonnie is located at 35.1 degrees north, 75.1 degrees west, moving northeast at a slow 7 miles per hour, minimum central pressure 10009 millibars, maximum sustained winds of 30 miles per hour, and yes, this system is basically quite close to the North Carolina Outer Banks. Actually, it's quite close to, Cape Hatteras at the moment. Additional heavy rainfall is expected to continue over coastal eastern North Carolina. Obviously, with the storm increasing a little bit with intensity, could also still have that potential for rip current threats. Two people that did happen to pass away while still active.
These are
yes. It was due to the rip current and waves out on the water. We do advise people, please, when these storms do come around, stay off the water, and don't risk your own life for going out for a little view of the sea or to go surfing. It's not worth it.
That's very good advice, here, Adam, for the deals. Very good advice.
Right. So I don't know if anyone wants to have anything else more to say about Bonnie before we go on to talk about the possibility of our next system. Anyone else has anything to say about the body? Right, okay, so next thing on the agenda for this hurricane season is the possibility of our next storm, which if it indeed become tropical storm or higher, its name would be Colin. As we can remember, we had Alex up in January, Bonnie, which is still kicking, and now we're at Colin. Right now, there's an area of disturbed weather in the southwestern Caribbean Sea that we're watching for possible development. There's quite a bit of uncertainty at the present time where exactly the system would kick off and where exactly it would track. However, general consensus is that system would eventually develop. Systems track will go through the northwestern Caribbean Sea, through the Gulf of Mexico, southeast Gulf of Mexico, and make its impact into Florida. Yes, I just did say Florida. Florida's hurricane shield, Florida's tropical shield might be failing, and Florida might get impacted by the system. So all you guys in Florida, as well as those in Cuba, the Cayman Islands, as well as the Yucatan, should be keeping very close attention to this. Even if it doesn't develop, it'll still be bringing a good bit of torrential downpour, flooding, possible rough seas, and some gusty winds. So if it develops or not, still you'd be expecting some pretty gnarly weather out of this.
That's agreed, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so Nathan, you have any words on this here?
Yes, well, I was just away for a few moments, but we're talking about the new system, which I would say has an extremely high chance of developing into a tropical storm. The models are, as far as I know, unanimous, I think, in it becoming at least a tropical storm somewhere.
Yes. Yeah, so a lot of the models agree at some point this system would develop. It's just the uncertainty of it is track and intensity of the system at this point. And exactly where this system would really kick off. That's the really main area. We could narrow it down to a general area, but we can't say exactly for sure at this time. Obviously, we'd need this disturbance to really consolidate more for model runs, particular storm-based model runs to be run off of this system before we could have a better idea on where this thing would go. And even to that, we would much rather wait till the hurricane hunters get flying into the system and determine what is what. At the moment, there is no current flights planned for the system. However, I do believe that will change as we get through the next 24 to 48 hours.
And if anyone has any questions for us during the stream, I know many people will probably be asking, I live in such a place, will it affect me? We'll try our best to answer them. Mashed Potatoes 2000 says, where in Florida would it likely impact? Now, there is a significant array of places that it could affect, and I think members of the team have differing opinions on that. But,
What we can say is that throughout the spread of the models, we could say its definite impact would be anywhere from from the southern tip of Florida, Florida Keys, all the way up to the northern northwestern Panhandle area, I would say. So the west coast of Florida looks like the most likely area to get the impact of the system. But of course, we are a good few days away. The system is going to be relatively slow developing and slow moving. So we do got a good couple of days to go. The time frame is a little bit kind of sketchy on exactly when this thing will get here. But overall, we're thinking about maybe around the middle of the week, next week, Wednesday or so.
Depends where you define here, but in Florida, it seems pretty likely that it'll be around day five, which would make it 1, 2, 3, Tuesday, possibly into Wednesday.
But of course, you know, models will flip and flop as they usually do. We would definitely ask everyone to just keep a close eye on it, watch it over the next couple of days, and as we get closer and closer to the time, the picture will become a lot more clearer.
Okay. Go on.
I do have to say, currently, if Nathan or one of you guys could be kindly enough, to screen share the Western Atlantic satellite, if possible.
I can't at the moment.
No. Looking on the Western Atlantic satellite, the system definitely appears to be consolidating along the southwest Caribbean at the point. Upper level winds at the moment aren't too great, however, it's a marked difference to what it was a couple of days ago. The upper level conditions are indeed improving over the years. And a decent amount of convection and thunderstorms are building and growing in the area. Actually, I have to admit, this is probably the strongest amount of convection over there that I've seen in months. So a lot of rainfall, a lot of stormy conditions are occurring in the area, and winds are indeed expected to increase, especially for areas like Western Jamaica, Honduras, Cayman Islands, Cuba. Over the next couple of days, the winds and the rough seas and the overall conditions will deteriorate as time goes by.
Yeah, we've got that imagery on our screen now. It's just appeared. And when you compare it to early this morning, it has the thunderstorm coverage must have doubled at least.
Pretty much. And basically, what's occurring for those guys who are a bit more in depth into meteorology, what there is, there's an upper level trough that's currently situated on the east coast of the United States, coming down through Florida and into the Northwest Caribbean. That upper level trough is weakening and starting to move out. An upper level ridge or an upper level anticyclone is starting to develop over those areas of thunderstorms, allowing for outflow to develop and allow these storms to build. And that is one of the key ingredients you need in developing storms. You need an upper level ridge, an upper level anticyclone to produce outflow and to allow the thunderstorms to build and build and build. And also to mention, sea surface temperatures across the Western Caribbean are very, very warm, within the 30-31 range. They're about for most of the Western Caribbean. And the ocean heat content in the area is pretty high for this time of year. So it is definitely something that needs to be watched. In terms of the intensity for the storms, models are kind of varying. Not really to scare people much, but I mean, realistically, we could go anywhere from tropical depression to maybe a weak hurricane. So it could be anywhere within there, especially with the, if the conditions are do become more so favorable, you could be looking on the high end of that scale there. If the conditions aren't as progresses aren't too favorable, we're looking at the low end of the scale. So it really just depends. We'll have to watch as time goes by.
I can see that sister Adam that we talked about, it should be circled. Mm-hmm. It's quite big actually.
Oh yes, definitely.
So I wouldn't be surprised if there's development late this weekend into next week. Yep. With the system. So.
Yes, so if any of you guys watching have any more questions, please keep them coming in. We will do our best to answer as much as possible. So please keep on bringing them in. If you don't mind, I'll be out for give me 1 minute. I'll be right back.
And now we're looking at a reconnaissance flight that's occurring over Bonny right now. Jason, what exactly is that telling us? Is that recording? Just trying to see the numbers there. Flight level wind of 35 knots so far.
So it's still a tropical depression.
Yep.
That would indicate a tropical depression indeed. And central pressure, the lowest, well not central, but the pressure they've found so far, around 1013, but that wasn't at the exact peak there, but I don't think it'll make much difference.
Yeah, very, so that would be flight level winds. The key thing we would be looking at is surface winds, which we should be getting quite soon. Give me two more seconds.
Yeah, actually, about that background noise, I want to apologize about the barking dog there.
Oh, he wants to be part of the show.
Sorry.
Jason, I don't know if you could show us the map that Force 13 created not so long ago, showing the projected track and intensity of what could be our next storm in the Atlantic, which I just sent off to you. I'm doing my own updates on the website for pre-storms and post-storms. The part in between seems to be well covered on the Force 13 tracking page, but we're also looking more in depth on the pre and post storm images. I think Jason's having trouble, so I'll try and get it on here myself. I just wanted to show it so that we could illustrate the possibilities of the system to our best efforts so far. And we'll have it there in just a moment. There it is.
Oh.
Behind the Skype window, there we are. It's been designated Alpha 6. That is the name that we've assigned the INVES. Well, it's not an INVES, it's an area of interest. And you can find that at the website force13.com/sews.html at the moment. That link might change, but for now it's there. And you can see what it's expected to do in the next 4 days. So initially there is a great deal of uncertainty exactly where it will track. Some models are saying that it will form, or indeed lead to the formation of a
tropical system
depression in around 2 days' time over the Yucatan Peninsula, or indeed over the Yucatan Channel, or a little bit further south in the Western Caribbean. Now, one of the models, the NavGem, is rather interesting. It takes the it already develops it into a tropical storm before impacting Western Cuba, and develops into a hurricane before impacting the Florida Keys, the Miami area, and then off towards the northeast as a significant hurricane, Category 1 or 2. That could well be the worst case scenario from this particular storm. But for the rest of Florida, a lot of the west coast, almost its entirety, is under that forecast cone there. don't really pay much attention at a central point, particularly with this storm, because there is a great deal of uncertainty at this early stage. Though I expect that with time, it will become a more confident forecast. I mean, a lot of the models are indicating, not conclusively, that this system that you saw on the satellite imagery not long ago is not the final system that will become Tropical Storm Colin, and it will in fact possibly transfer its energy to another system perched off the Yucatan Peninsula, which will then become Tropical Storm Colin. So, quite a few variables, it would seem. One or two models do predict that the current system right now will become Colin. Either way, it seems pretty likely that the tropical storm will form. I think it's unanimous in the models. I don't think I've seen a single model run yet that has not called for Colin to form. So that's around 6 or 7 out of 7, which is usually the best possible indicator that we're going to see a storm, and very rarely, if ever, are 100% of the models wrong. But they may change when the next runs come out in about 6 hours' time.
I'm back. Just wanted to also add to that, Nathan, is that it's important to note that that models at the moment are definitely not so great because of we don't have a tagged system as of yet, and we don't have reconnaissance flights going into the system. Once that does happen, that's when you could look for model accuracy to come into play. At the moment, it's just a couple of models throwing something out there, and it's becoming more likely because they all have some sort of consensus of some sort. But that's the general consensus of what this thing will do. It'll be a lot more accurate as time goes by, but even more so accurate once we get an aircraft into the system, and once the system is tagged.
Well, indeed, by no means is it me calling for people to prepare to evacuate from a hurricane, because by no means is that going to be a possibility yet.
Although I do urge people, you know, it is the start of the season. You guys should have been preparing from weeks before, and if you decided to leave it till this late in time, I urge you to go and stock up and prepare yourselves now, just in case. Remember to get your water, get your non-perishables, your flashlights, your radios, all the stuff, and take them, put them in containers, pack them away in a corner somewhere, and have them ready just in case. And check, make sure you check the dates on canned food and stuff. Make sure they're not going to be expiring within the next 6 months or so.
It's funny, and no matter how civilized we get, the advice never changes, does it?
Does not change much at all. You know, I'm pretty sure some people would say, oh, you're starting to sound like a broken record. Well, the truth is, we have to sound like a broken record because some people just still don't get it yet. So, again, as being a broken record, start preparing now. No matter the situation, if this storm comes or doesn't come, you still prepare.
Yeah, well, you will never know what's gonna happen the next day, so it's better take the precautions of everything, because the people think that if anything is not coming, or they think they are safe, and when something arrives unexpectedly, the effects could be very bad, and maybe it could be a disaster.
I could give you one example here, which was back in 2004 when we had Hurricane Ivan coming through the Caribbean. It was initially forecasted to go through Jamaica, impacting near the sister islands of the Cayman Islands, Cayman Brac and Little Cayman, and then make landfall in central to west Cuba. And then when the storm came close to Jamaica, it decided to make a little wobble, decided that it didn't want to pass through Jamaica, and ended up pretty much making landfall here in Grand Cayman. Now people in Grand Cayman, they were expecting a storm to be passing over to the sister islands and not over the main island. And a few people were definitely not prepared for that.
Of course. Well, a hurricane is a very massive storm with incredibly effects in land. So, well, it's still some doubts about why people still thinking that they will not gonna receive any effects or they will not gonna happen anything with them. Well, I don't know how to say exactly about that, but when I received Hurricane Alex almost 6 years ago, people thought that they are gonna be safe because it was a barrier built to control the flooding. But despite of that barrier, the flooding was incredibly bad. A lot of houses were destroyed. The river was about 130% of its capacity, and well, all the people that died in my area, they was because they were very close to the river and just taking a look of that, and they haven't prepared for taking all the precautions. So, well, is nothing. Well, a cyclone or hurricane is nothing that you need to play. It's just like I'm going to see, but taking the precautions, you know, and not playing with that is you're playing with your life, literally. But yes, you will never. You never can be prepared for something like that. I don't know how to say it, but it's something that you can never be prepared 100%, but at least you can save your life.
Yes, yes indeed. So while we're on this topic, how about we talk about what you would be expecting to buy on your supply list for the season, shall we? Shall we have a chat about what you would need to what you need to pick up from the grocery store or from your hardware store? The stuff that you need to pick. Give me 2 seconds here. Okay. Well, let's just start off with the basic list of stuff. Obviously, for whatever electronic devices you may have, whether cell phone, radio, whatever, flashlights, all of that. You're definitely going to need your batteries and extra batteries to replace. There will be times when power will go out and you may not have power for a good long while. So always carry extra sets of charged batteries for those rechargeable ones, and for those non-rechargeable ones, extra batteries for that. You get canned food, canned meat, fruit, vegetables, that kind of stuff. Cereals, get cereals, coffee, tea, hot chocolate, condensed milk or evaporated milk, canned milk. You get canned soups, some kind of stuff, peanut butter, jellies, jams. You know, you get fruit juices. Make sure you get water. Make sure you get, you could get those large cases of those gallon bottled waters or those pint-sized bottles of water. Get a couple of cases of those, you know, hand sanitizer, wipes. You could get, for if you have any children, young kids, you know, you're going to need baby food, kids food, diapers, that kind of stuff. For adults, for older adults and the elderly, you're gonna need you know, special items for them. You know, the adult diapers, sanitary wipes, their medicine. Need medicine for the whole family. Make sure you have extra prescriptions and so on. You're also gonna need your personal documents, your passports, your social security or your identification, your insurance cards. Have all that packed away in a watertight bag and packed closely to you. You're definitely going to need to get equipment and supplies to do the help with the cleanup work afterwards. Have a machete, knife. Have rope. Have your wellies, boots. You could rain jacket. You know, a small tool kit with, you know, like screwdrivers and etc. Wrenches and so on. I'm not sure if I missed anything else. I'm pretty sure I have. If anyone else wants to add to that list of stuff that you would want to carry and have with you as your supplies.
Martinez says, and if you live in the deep south like redneck country, self-defense, please don't do it.
Yes. However, I think international law states that if you're going to a public shelter, you must keep your weapons at your own house and so on. Unless if some states do have the open carry license, and that they do legitimately allow you to carry your weapons into shelters, I would advise for all of you guys to check your local laws. Make sure you don't want to get yourself in a pickle when there's a storm on the way.
Well, 63 degrees at Force 13 HQ. I think we haven't given it a mention yet. 91E, and what it may well do in the eastern Pacific could become a significant tropical storm. One or two models saying a potential hurricane on the cards. What do you guys think?
I think it'll become a tropical storm only. I think it'll be quite a weak system.
Would agree as well. I have my doubts on a strong system or the system going to hurricane intensity, but at this point it really honestly doesn't matter, because this storm will not be affecting land. If anything, only affecting the fishes in the water and maybe boaters out on the open water, ships and boaters out on the open water. So that's pretty much it for that system.
And the researchers and record keepers who care about the storm.
Yeah, yes, that's very true.
Definitely. But at least if this does happen, at least finally the East Pack season finally starts a little bit later than usual. But finally.
Well, actually, we need to see a cyclone in the Western Pacific, because it's very, very weird that any tropical storm has formed and it's June.
Not that weird, though.
No, it's not that weird. No.
Well, considering not we're coming weird, out of the El Nino.
But, well, we almost every year see at least like two or three tropical cyclones before June in the Western Pacific, and just we saw a tiny tropical depression, but that was only monitored by JMA and not by...
But as I've said before, the biggest, one of the biggest El Ninos, 1997-98. And in 1998, after that, the West Pacific had its latest start on record in early July.
Really?
So,
wow.
I think we won't see a storm in the West Pac for at least two or three more weeks yet.
Damn. Well, but that, but at the same time can be like dangerous because all that energy, it will still not, well, it will still like keeping there and there and then a cyclone can organize and maybe could be strong. And well, I don't know how to explain that exactly, but something well, says to me that
I was doing something, research. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, but I think that if an area of I'm sorry, if a cyclone doesn't organize in or well in a specific area doesn't have any cyclones by a long period of time, then it will be a day that a lot of cyclones can form and most of them can be intense for that energy that was accumulated. I think so, but I'm not sure. Not sure really, but possibly could happen.
Yeah, I was just saying about the research I've been doing recently about the Western Pacific. By the way, the Eastern Pacific, if this system forms, it will be the latest start since 2011, if it forms. But as far as the Western Pacific is concerned, there's an uncanny likeness after three big El Nino events, 1973, 1983, and 1998. In all three occasions, the first storm formed in late June or early July. The first three storms were weak, and the fourth storm was a major typhoon of Category 3 or higher. Will that trend repeat again this year? I just like throwing little things out there that make people think.
Don't worry.
Sorry.
Nathan, you think we could take a quick 5 minutes?
Yes, I suppose. Interesting time to take a quick 5 minutes, but
just a quick 5 minutes.
We'll go ahead and leave you with the outdoor noise that we've been playing for most of the afternoon, and regather ourselves shortly. I'll leave you with the image that I created not so long ago, showing the potential track for our latest area of interest. This is Force 13 Live, continuing the talk tropics. In front of you, you can see the current projection for what we've designated to be named Alpha 6, a area of interest, which is located in the Caribbean, just off to the east of the Nicaragua-Honduras border. And the system is possibly going to organize, and we expect that in around 3 days' time we will see the birth, potentially, of Tropical Storm Colin. Who knows exactly where? It could be over the Yucatan, could be in between Yucatan and Cuba, then the channel, or it could be over western Cuba. I guess the consensus that we've sort of seen so far is maybe that the further east it goes, the more strong it could get, potentially. Though the forecast track from several models, they do differ quite a bit when it comes to Florida in particular. We could see, it seems almost inevitable that whatever this becomes will make landfall in Florida, regardless of intensity. But we don't know whether it will be somewhere off and on the panhandle, or could even be as south as the Upper Keys. And that very small possibility in that forecast cone there, that it'll miss Florida completely, but it will still give Florida effects no matter where exactly it goes. And also just something else I wanted to point out that we've not really discussed, and certainly not visible on this map, is that beyond that 96-hour period, and when it gets beyond Florida out in the Gulf Stream, most models are predicting that it will intensify and deepen over that area. So there is quite a possibility that it could become a hurricane out at sea over there as it moves off towards the northeast and could possibly skirt the Outer Banks on the way out. As far as its very late development is concerned, it will probably turn post-tropical, assuming all the models are correct, which is not a very good thing to assume, but as it is right now, that the models say that the storm will probably turn post-tropical southeast of Atlantic Canada and could possibly interact with another extratropical low and possibly deliver inclement conditions to Nova Scotia and Newfoundland. You can also see on the left hand side there the latest floater for Tropical Depression Bonnie. Interesting there. I don't know whether we've got any visible imagery of that, perhaps. That might be rather interesting to see. But as of right now, that's the situation with Bonnie. I don't think there are any warnings in effect. It's still a tropical depression and is not expected to turn into a tropical storm, but is expected to move out towards the east. Having said that, one model, I think it was the CMC or the HWRF, did predict that Bonnie would reattain tropical storm status as it moved away from the Outer Banks and lose tropical storm status once it drew parallel longitudinally to Bermuda, though it would be quite a way north of Bermuda when it drew parallel. So that's the situation in the Atlantic. In the Eastern Pacific, 91E is likely to become a tropical cyclone. Quite what its intensity is going to be is somewhat unknown. Let me just see if I can get the latest intensity forecasts from several models to see what it exactly says. And it's more of the same, really, from what we were talking about yesterday, that the intensity at maximum, this is a HWRF, predicting, usually is extremely bullish, but even it is rather subdued and isn't even predicting a tropical storm anymore. It was predicting a weak one yesterday and is now predicting only a tropical depression. But the ship's models are still going far out. Yesterday, one of them predicted a 100 mile an hour category 2. Now it's just a little bit less much, and still one of the ship's models does predict a 85 mile an hour category 1 hurricane, but that is very unlikely indeed. As far as track's concerned, several of the models say that the storm will move, well, of course it will move in a westerly direction, but one or two of the models say it will curve off towards the north. Over to you.
All right, okay. Delcios is myself. Alright, okay. Well, I can't invent 20 floaters on the stadium, but I don't see them 20 getting any stronger than tropical storm status. Maybe can't win a record, but I'm not 100% confident on that.
Well, we'll return in a few moments' time.
Yeah,
we'll take a short break. If you've got any comments for us in this period, do let us know, and we'll send you a message. We'll send a reply through the stream, I guess.
That would be the best of one.
You're watching Force 13 Live. We're going to take a short break now. We'll be back at the top of the next hour, which is when we'll be running Force 13's open mic, and we'll discuss the current storm situation in more detail, perhaps, as one or two of the members on here have taken just a wee break. Back in a few moments.